The following program is presented by the Theosophical Society in America, a worldwide organization dedicated to the study of comparative religion, philosophy, and science. The Theosophical philosophy offers a comprehensive worldview to the end that we may better understand ourselves and our place in the universe. The Structure and Function of the Chakras, a discussion with Dr. Shafira Kiragula and Mrs. Dora Kunz. Mrs. Kunz is a teacher of therapeutic touch and is currently president of the Theosophical Society in America. For the past several years, she has worked extensively with Dr. Kiragula as part of a research project on the chakras. Dr. Kiragula is a neuropsychiatrist. She received a research fellowship in the Department of Neurology and Neurosurgery at McGill University and the Montreal Neurological Institute in Canada, and for 3.5 years worked as consultant psychiatrist with the world-famous neurosurgeon, Dr. Wilder Penfield.
The idea and the word chakra, which means in the English language, four centers, is very old, but it specifically is in Indian literature and Indian philosophy. There has been described a system of these four centers are all over or closely related to the body. And I thought, before I asked Dr. Kiragula to explain something about her research project, that I would point out where the chakras are located, so we have a system outlined before we speak. So let us first start with the center in the heart, which is very often referred to as the spiritual center in man. This is located a little bit above the physical heart, more towards the center of the body, and it is like a wheel, and many petaled spokes, you could call them petals or spokes of a wheel, which gently rotates. This has a core, and this core is related very much to the nature of man's spiritual or higher emotions. We feel that each of these centers is also located where or near a gland, and we feel it has a relationship or a correlation to the thymus gland. The next gland which we'll describe is also very well known. It is the center, in the center of the throat. It is equally a wheel, and the general color is more in the region of blue-violet and not so much in the golden hues of the heart center. This center has been always associated with the idea of sound, creativity, that people who are artists use this a great deal. But it also rotates like all of them. This, we feel, is associated with the two important glands, which are really right underneath it, the thyroid and the parathyroid. Then if we move upwards, we go to the brow center, and this has been really associated with the idea of vision, clairvoyance, but also it is associated with the idea of clear visualization and thinking. And we feel it is associated with the glands in the center of the head, the pituitary, and the pineal. Then the biggest chakra, the biggest center, is on top of the head, really in the center of the head, and it's by far the biggest wheel of the of all of them. And I think it's an important one because it relates to consciousness. And this will be explained at a later stage. Now I think we will shift. We'll shift from the head to back to the center of the stomach.
Abdomen, if you
want. Abdomen.
Yes,
maybe
abdomen.
That's a more elegant word. And we call that the solar plexus center. This is again a wheel which very often rotates faster than any of the others, because this has a great deal to do with our everyday emotions and our turbulent emotions. This is particularly associated in the glands, with the pancreas, the with the kidneys, and I think with the adrenals, because it is very much concerned with disturbances in our emotional pattern. But it also, and this is important, associated with the next and much smaller center, which we call the spleen center. The spleen center is not really written up or described in any of the Hindu literature. This is much more a part of the theosophical literature. And from my point of view, it's a subsidiary center. It has a great deal to do with the intake of prana or vitality. And from my point of view, it's closely related to the center here. But it is also has a very close relation to the liver. The liver is the greatest detoxifier in the body, and thus it has a relationship with our health. And now we come to one of the not such a big center in size, but a very important one. It's at the base of the spine. It is related to the enormous nerves which are ending in the spine and energizes the spine. And finally, it has a great deal to do finally with the center at the top of the head. All of these have a stem which is related to our spine. And this is all I want to say about the placement of these centers. Now I'm going to ask Dr. Karagula to say something about her own background and how she became interested in this.
I'm a neuropsychiatrist by training, as you know, and I was interested in abnormal experiences people had. I was in Edinburgh, where I did some work on these different types of hallucinations, and I always felt that the hallucinations were physiological in their abnormality, in their constituency, that the content was maybe depending on the person, but that the experience in itself was abnormal, let's say, a toxicity of the brain or any damage to the brain and so forth. And Penfield wrote a book called The Cerebral Cortex, The Function of the Cerebral Cortex, in which he describes very clearly similar, but not identical experiences, where in patients who had the brain opened, and he would stimulate different parts of the brain, and he would elicit, somebody will hear a voice, somebody will see a vision, depending which part of the brain was being studied. Now, it sort of in my own mind, I felt they were very close, and my interest was really to find out where mental disease stems from. So I came and worked for about 3.5 years with Dr. Penfield and studied over 100 patients of his cases with these experiences, and comparing the mentally ill patients and those who had seizures or epileptic seizures with what we used to call an aura, but the term is the thing, an experience of what the patient really first feels, and compared the two together. And when I came to New York, somebody said to me, well, there are other things some people see. Now, for a person who has spent about 12 years with abnormal experiences of people or electrical stimulation, and they said, well, there are people who can see right through the human body. And now, to me, that was a very curious thing. Or they can see at a distance. that these have been verified. And I was then introduced to Mrs. Dora Van Gilder Kunz, who's well known, I think, for being known in New York, and I was fortunate to make that contact. Now, being a physician and a neuropsychiatrist, my interest was one way to verify whether what she sees is correct or not. I do not know at first how she saw or what she saw. And as she was describing before, she described the center with its segments. Maybe I should illustrate that as a petal of a flower. That's why sometimes the Hindu call the segment the thing.
You're describing an average.
An average center. An average
center
are segments in it, which they call the petals. And the center, this is, let's say, the core, what we sometimes refer as the core. And that the core, let's say, this is a center. She would describe that the center is really, let's take the throat center, which we did a lot of research work on, that the throat center right in the, just at the edge of the etheric field, there is a vortex with the center of these. Now there are three or four movements in it, which you didn't, well, let you have, you describe how you see it, maybe that's the better. And that from here, what we call the core eventually, the center where the energy enters, goes back through the thing, energizes the thyroid, according to her theory, which was verified later on, and then it goes to the spine, and via the spine, the energy comes out and creates the field. Now, it is in this etheric, maybe I should illustrate just what you mean
Go
by
ahead.
That. Now, if we this is just simulation, all right? If we took this, what was very interesting, if we took, these will be the segments, and this will be the core of the center. If we spin it, you see there's a movement. Now, when we came to see disturbed patients, now you tell what you saw in patients in which the thyroid was abnormal. Let's say I wanted to correlate her perception. If it was correct, these centers had any effect on the physical body, she should be able to see the as far as I'm concerned, my only test medically was to see how the thyroid functions. You saw yourself how the center was, and the correlation of the center and its abnormality could be related to the gland, which was medically known. Now, you describe what you saw in the center of the thyroid, let's say. What do you see in that there?
This is, of course, very different from the center of both
I
the
know,
chakras.
But by simulation.
But I think what one sees is there would be parts which would be dull, for instance, or not there, or the same, this would be removed, which would indicate to me that there would be an operation and there would be nothing there. So it would be like really a great deal of these things which are protruding in this particular thing, they wouldn't there. Yeah. Or in other parts, that part of this, instead of being there, would be down.
The thing will be down, bent downward, or there were abnormalities in the color sometimes you described, correct?
Yes.
Now, the other thing which was interesting to me is the way you describe the rhythm of the center. Let's take the throat center again. Some would rotate, in a normal person, they would rotate normally and the spin remains. Now, in people who might have hyperactivity of the thyroid, you saw the spin faster and more abnormal, correct? Is that correct?
Yeah,
you agree?
Jerky.
Now it will spin back. Now, in some who had hypothyroid, it went slow.
That's right.
Correct?
When there was too much, speed it up. And when there wasn't enough,
There wasn't enough speeding and the color slightly changed. So if we take, but you didn't describe, tell us, and I'll ask you to do that, really, how that you don't see these not only in the throat, thyroid, but also you see them on the emotional level and the mental level in the same area. Is that correct? So you have in each vortex, in each center, you have three. That correct? You describe.
Yes.
In every field, you see these interrelatedness, don't you?
Yes, I see an interrelationship. At all these different levels, they do not know, look exactly alike.
No.
But the same thing, the rhythm is synchronous. But sometimes, and I think this indicated a disturbed pattern to me, is if there was no synchronicity in the speed, for instance.
Yes.
In other words, say sometimes instead of hooking up all the energies flowing from one to the other, there was a break, for instance.
That was interesting, I think, in some of the thyroid patients we did. For instance, some patients where there was a hyperactivity in the movement and the centers, Some of those patients, there was definitely no, let me just say, these cases we did together were really medically diagnosed by people then other than ourselves. It was an endocrine clinic in New York City where we had the privilege to go in and make exact report of what the medical history was. In some of the patients, the thyroid was removed actually because of cancer or hyperactivity or tumors. And what was interesting to me to see a correlation between what you saw and what medically we could verify was the fact that whenever there was an abnormal rhythm in the center or the chakra, invariably we also had in the medical record an abnormality in the gland related to that part of the center. The second thing which was very interesting to me, when the chakra is not removed when the gland is removed, that correct? Mm-hmm. So the chakra remains, although the surgeon would remove the thyroid, and when there was no thyroid, your description, it is, I don't see anything. It is absent. There is lack of energy where you would see the thyroid. So it gave an evidence. I mean, you didn't say really it was surgically removed. You described the energy pattern, an absence of energy. And I thought that was very interesting in those cases. We had also cases in which, unfortunately at that time in New York, they had removed the pituitary of the patient, of the ajna center or the brow center, for therapeutic purposes. They would remove it thinking that since the pituitary gland or the pituitary gland controls all the glands in the body, that if they removed it, they would slow the cancer process. And in some patients, we studied both, not only the throat which showed the cancer, but also studied the ajna, which was not abnormal basically, but had been removed surgically. Why don't you describe how you saw that center?
I would like to say this, that as in this clinic, I sat about 20 feet away from the patient, mm-hmm. and I never saw anything but the back of their head.
That's correct.
And thus you used to point out and say, look at that boy with the funny red hair, or somebody with a hat, and I never at any time saw their face.
That's correct. I mean, not only you didn't see the face, you never asked a single question.
Well, I could hardly ask the questions when you were not anywhere near me.
Well, when Dora was, I would come in and ask, give her a case, a man or the boy with the red head or the woman with the red coat, and I left her there with a chart to fill in the points that she looks and she sees in the energy pattern, and I would extract the medical case history, and then it was really after we went home that we compared notes and found how accurate she was in her observations. I think medically this is a very interesting and very important factor to realize these energy fields which have been described in the past throughout centuries, and you see patterns of them in art, in whether it is Hindu art or Christian art or Catholic art, in all arts. It's been fascinating to see how these things are. That they have been those only who had this gift of perceiving these energy fields. Now, could you tell us a little bit more how you perceive that? That
I perceive it as a flow, and I think a great deal, from my perspective, and I think it's healthy or unhealthy, is the luminosity. I think that's the best. A person who is perfectly healthy, these centers have a definite luminosity. If they become dull, and even if there's a gray deal of gray, that indicates to me there's a disease pattern. And from that point of view, I am able to perceive not only the center, but I'm looking for the disease pattern, particularly in these particular cases, in the glands, because we were definitely in an endocrine clinic. So I looked for the patterns in the glands itself, and they looked completely gone. The energy pattern was gone. And when there was the operation which removed the glands, it made a very definite change in the energy pattern of the chakra, but the chakra was still functioning.
Right. That's good. Right. That's
because there is, and I want to state this over and over again, there is a difference between the three levels in the chakra and the physical organ. This fourth center will continue.
Why don't you tell us how you, let me just maybe give the medical history and I'll have Dora describe what she saw in the solar plexus. If she not only saw the chakras and their relationship to the glandular system and the states of consciousness of patients, but she also sometimes, if she looked at the solar plexus, she will know whether there's a blockage in the gut or not, where the energy flow in the field wasn't really there. And some of these cases that we did see together, there was absolute confirmation surgically. The few days later, you know, remember the case you saw with me, neither one of us at the time knew the patient had anything, and then you saw that there was a blockage on the descending colon, and I felt a little bit uncomfortable, actually. I'm wondering if Dora is correct this time, because the woman was with me, she had been able to eat, no symptoms, and Dora says, no, there's a blockage there, and gets up and points it on the abdomen of the person. She was a well-known writer and a well-known person, and half an hour later, we found out she had just come up from the x-ray department, and she wasn't sure whether she had any growth in the descending colon or not. 3 days later, she was operated, and the cancer was removed from that area, and we saw her post-operatively and observed the changes in the field later on.
What I remember, it's happened several years ago, is a slowing down, first of all, I think, of the speed of the center, and there were some disturbing energies in the center. And when I looked at the intestines or the colon, there where the relationship was in a specific spot, in the colon, which I felt had an obstruction in it, which was reflected in the chakra, but it wasn't. It was not in the chakra. It was only a reflection of the physical condition in the chakra. And I felt pretty certain that there was a physical obstruction of some sort. I never say whether they have cancer or not. I say there are obstructions here and there.
You were able to reoccur it like everybody else. Most of the times you hadn't seen really very severely ill patients where there was cancer and parts removed and so forth. In time, I think you were, after experience, relating what you perceived, you're pretty accurate to see how this
As we spent so much time in a cancer clinic, I began to feel when I saw red energies in there, and also a change in the rhythm, that this probably indicated cancer.
Now, if a patient, maybe cancer of the breast is so common, and we had a number of patients who had cancer of the breast. Now, you see not only the center, which is related to the throat pattern, throat center, etherically, but you also saw an abnormality within the chest.
That's correct.
And then when the energy or the women, some women had the breast removed, you could see the vital or the etheric field wasn't as normal as on the other side.
No, it was an absence.
Could you describe how you would see that?
Well, I mean, there is a movement and all around through the breast. If the breast is removed completely, the center of that energy is around and the energy goes through the periphery.
One of the fascinating thing to me as a physician that without anatomical structure understanding, we had a patient who was a person of goodwill. He was really a minister who had used some healing in his work with people. And sometimes the energy field is not symmetrical on both sides of the body. That's correct?
Yes.
Some people have a little bit more energy on one side than the other. And he always said that his right hand was more sensitive than his left. And when you looked at him, it was true. He had more vitality, a flow of energy through his hands than he had in the left hand. Now, this minister had a stroke, which was a damage to part of the brain. He was unable to speak. I'd known him before. Unable to speak. And he had aphasia and apraxia, what we call. And I was interested to see how you saw this damage to the brain. Without an anatomical structure, you saw at the head, the left side of the head of the minister, that the field was fragmented. Mm-hmm. All on the left side was fragmented. But what was more interesting to me, the right side, which was paralyzed, which I would have expected her to describe fragmentation, she says, no, the field is intact, the lines of force, the energy, instead of being at right angle this way to the body, they were drooping downward. And that was a perfect description from an anatomical structure. We know the left side, damage to the left side of the brain gives paralysis or weakness on the right side. And without that anatomical knowledge, you describe perfectly correctly how the anatomical energy is. One other thing I could say that you didn't think at first that people can have their brain removed, part of their brain removed, not all of it, but
and
part
survive.
Of the brain, and survive. So one of the patients was one of mine whom I knew all the case medical history, the amount of brain that was damaged, and so forth, and they were operated on by Dr. Wilder Penfield. In these two, several patients we did, and one of the patients I'll describe, the patient had abnormalities of seizures in which they were very emotional. In these two patients we saw especially, there was a sensation in the body and then the patient would exit, you know, would be unconscious. When Dora looked at the brain, the electroencephalogram was what is known EEG, had shown in some of the cases, that there was abnormality in the rhythm in the brain on both sides of the brain, usually. And in the average person even, if you have an epileptic seizure or people with temporal lobe epilepsy, the abnormality is localized to one side and it's easier to pick up, it's clear cut. But these two cases, especially those two cases, were very difficult. They had abnormalities on both sides. And there was like a crisscrossing of all the energies where they were dysrhythmic. And when Dora looked at them, when you looked at them, you saw not only she had never seen anything like it before, and she described the dysrhythmia of the two sides of the brain and how they interact and are functioning abnormally. And when I asked you to look down and see more what you see inside the brain, how do you see the impulses travel back and forth? And from your own personal observation, you said, it's really funny what I'm seeing. I said, what is it? You said, just describe it. She said, most of the time I see the energy come from the top to the bottom and then moves into there. But in these, there's a gap. There is an absence of something. It's an emptiness. She said, I don't know what it is. There's an empty on that side. And she was perfectly clear. Part of the brain had been removed and there were no impulses in that part of the brain. The center of the top head center where you're describing, I think it's on the top in one of them localized. Is that correct?
Yeah.
All right. You saw abnormality in some of the segment, the petals of the center, and instead of being all flattened, some of them were fragmented and broken down, and there was in some of them cut off almost. And the center, the core, what we call the core of the petal or the center, there was also a dysrhythm there. Now, I found out working with you that when you describe that the core is in trouble, I know the person is in trouble as far as the actual disease process related to that part. If it's the petal, there's more likely it will be healed maybe in time and therapy. But if the center are disturbed in the core, we're looking for more trouble. One other thing maybe I should mention is that cases of studies, I began to detect which ones will develop certain problems in a little bit longer time than you were seeing at the patient. And unfortunately, some of these were friends of mine where I could keep tab on them, so to speak, not ordinary patients. And sometimes you saw the energy pattern being disturbed a year, 2 years, 3 years before the disease process manifested. Was that, you'd agree with that?
Yes, I think one can see the beginning in some cases. All right. Of a disease process. I think it's not easy to trace even medically the beginning of a disease process because nobody goes to doctors till they feel really bad, don't think.
You know how I look upon it? I was puzzled when you did that for me first. You know, I didn't know just how was this going to happen. And then I began to think, and after all, it's like the incubation period in a disease process. The patient has the infection in his body. And many of them may be a week before we see the manifested disease. Some we have 3 weeks. And there is an exact pattern of the disease infection in the body before it is expressed in the physical body. And it made sense to me to see it maybe in the chakras or the centers ahead of time, a year maybe or 2 years, gives us an indication that we're heading for trouble. Now, I think future medicine, I hope, people like you will be there to help us find out how to change that pattern before the disease is set in. I think that's the most important point. That would be predictive and preventive medicine.
Let me say this. Dr. Karagula has described something of the work we did in correlating the findings of medicines with my perception in these centers. I think that the power of the mind, which is finally also in the third field in these chakras, can have a powerful healing effect in the person, because I think in part of disease, in all disease really, there's a psychosomatic quality. Everybody who has a serious disease is very profoundly disturbed. And so part of the difficulty in the chakra is the tremendous anxiety and fear people feel. And I think this, of course, which even if it's normal, does affect and the disease. If it's possible for the person to find a mode of quieting his mind and radically changing his mind picture, I think there is a possibility to affect the chakra and even the diseased part underneath or near it or whatever it is. It isn't so much important that one should think about the chakra, but I think one should think about the anxiety, the fear, and see to conquer, in other words, to change oneself. Because we must not forget that the power of the third part of the chakra can have a very powerful effect on the whole of the bodily well-being. But meditation and concentration and be having a detachment in one way from one's physical suffering and concentrating on these other powers, I think can very often have a healing effect. I think this is what, finally, what I want to say. What would you like to say?
I would like to say that I have met maybe a few more people who had similar abilities to Mrs. Kunz, but I think she's the best I've come across. She's always ready to observe and correlate and understand that correlation. We've had a lot of other tests beside the physical body, whether from seeing a radioactive substance to seeing other things, and the confirmation has always been correct.
Thank you.